Welcome to our beautiful show, the Yaba TV Show. My name is Yasia, your host. We have a fabulous show for you today. The topic is, how do we bridge the gap between Africans and African Americans? Well, I have the answer for you today. So you need to tell your friends, everybody you know about our fabulous show, because today, my first guest on the show is Dr. Cheyenne Bryant. She is the founder of Dr. Bryant Institute. She's also a life coach with Psychology Life Coach, and she's the president of NAACP San Pedro Women Team Branch. She has so much to offer you today. And then my second guest is
Osayande Agaze.
Osayande is a brother from Nigeria. She's into movie making in Hollywood. And not only that, he has his own business, Nature Harbor Life. And he's going to offer you so much about bridging the gap between Africans and African Americans. So you are in for a treat. Tell everybody you know about our fabulous show, the Yaba TV Show. We'll be back in a moment. Welcome back to our beautiful show, the Yaba TV Show. I am your host, Sia Sia. Some people know me as Yaba. And my guest on the show today, she is just a wonderful, wonderful lady of character, integrity, and everything you can think about as a very special woman who is a voice maker, movers and shakers of the community. She's one of them, Dr. Cheyenne Bryant. Welcome back to the show.
Yeah, but thank you for having me. It's definitely been due time for us to have this conversation and for me to be on your show. It's a privilege, so thank you.
Wonderful. So when we talk about bridging the gap between Africans and African Americans, what comes to mind?
What comes to mind for me is cultural competence, cultural sensitivity. And as much as we use those terms when it comes to folks who are outside of what I call the Black community, which I also include with Africans in that African American Black community, that term is usually used toward folks outside of that. But within our community, as Black people, as Africans, as African Americans, we need to have cultural competence and cultural sensitivity toward and within one another. And so when I think of that, I think of that sensitivity and that competence so that we can respect each other's differences. And because of that difference, we do have to have the investment of studying and researching and understanding the culture, and then having the competence to have the compassion and the acceptance of the differences being beautiful and not allowing the differences to create a wedge, which unfortunately is already there in different areas.
Talking about different areas, communication is one of the areas.
Yeah.
For example, in Africa, most of the time when you're talking to an elderly person and you are the younger person, you're not supposed to look straight in the eyes, no eye contact. That means it's disrespect. Wow. Unlike in this society here, it's the opposite. Tell me about this.
I guess my African descendants are definitely all in my DNA, mm-hmm. because although that is not the African-American culture here, as you just stated, that is a value that I believe in. And so I'm happy you brought that up, because although I'm not, you know, originally born in Africa, obviously mm-hmm. I'm an African-American woman, Black woman, and I also have those values. I love that respect, angle that culture does have. Now, to implement it here, when we've already have the culture you've already mentioned being so established, mm-hmm. of course, that would be something that would be probably problematic, right? Because you're trying to change up a whole generational culture that doesn't exist here. That's one of the gaps that I believe involves dialogue and conversation and the respect of, we may not do that here or in our household, but we respect it in your culture. We respect it in your household. It doesn't make it wrong. It just makes it beautifully different.
Beautifully different. Mm-hmm. I like that. Mm-hmm. You know, in our African communities, most of the time, the women, especially the one from the village, they are introvert. They don't come out and outspokenly speak like most African-American ladies do, especially women. Let's talk about that.
I love that you said that. I had the opportunity to visit South Africa. I went to Johannesburg, and then we flew over to Cape Town. Two totally different South African, states or continents? I don't want to say it wrong, but two totally different African areas, both in South Africa.
Countries,
thank you. But I say that to say I did notice that though, Yaba, that the African women there, especially the younger women, were very introvert, a little more timid in the sense of not being outspoken. And obviously here, you know, in the States, African American women are very outspoken. We have a voice. It's respected. We could be, you know, we are allowed the permission to demand and command a presence and have our voice being heard, which I love and I live by and I use it, obviously. Africa has, from my experience of being there, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, the environment there, the people that are there that are not African, or should I say not Black Africans, they don't make it easy, nor do they appear to, when I was there, respect the voices of not just African women, but African men. That's one thing I didn't like. That's one thing that really rubbed me wrong. And it was heartbreaking to see that there was no representation at that level. And I was like, oh my God, you know, I was like in that moment, of course, I'm like, I got to come back here and attempt to do something. But as a one man band, that isn't a job for just me. That's a job for me, for you, for people to come together collectively and say, we need to go back into this country and we have to not just implement, you know, some human rights, right? But also teach and educate and show our people that are in Africa, the people that look like us, how to have a voice. Because it's not just that they don't. I believe that they weren't taught how to. I believe yes. They do have a voice, but it's hidden. I believe that they do have ideas, but it's hidden. And or they know that if it's expressed, then it's not respected. So there's no empowerment for them to say, wait a minute, I have something to say. And I do have value and I do have worth and I am a young woman and I do have dreams and you're going to hear me out and you're going
to
respect it.
They need to be taught.
They need to be taught that.
So let's talk about you, Dr. Brian, your success story. You've achieved quite a lot for your age. You're a young woman and you're a life coach. You have Dr. Brian's Institute. Let's talk about your success story.
I have my book that I wrote a few years ago that happens to be number one on Google. From there, it was number one in the top 20 books written by African Americans across our nation. And what I'm about to say, I say humbling without bragging, but Oprah was someone who I really, really admired, you know, as a young girl, which most of us have. And yes. To see my book be number one in the top 20, and I believe Oprah came in at number 8 or 9. Mm-hmm. Les Brown was like number 9 or 10. Maya Angelou was even on that list. To see myself be number one amongst such powerhouse people, such ancestors like Maya Angelou, you know, rest in peace. To see me be a number one on that list.
It's amazing.
Mm-hmm. It's amazing. It's more than just, oh, I got number one. It's, wow, I'm in alignment with phenomenal women who came before me, who I respected and who I know is you know, Maya Angelou being an ancestor now, you know, but are proud of the work that I'm doing because it says a lot to be even in the same space as
you. You have to be proud, definitely.
Yeah, feels
it's
good.
An achievement.
Feels good.
How can our audience reach you?
Absolutely. They can reach me on social media at _DrBryant. My website's drbryant.co. That's drbryant.co, not .com. And I just want to say one more thing. Success Magazine just labeled me about a week ago as the woman who broke the glass ceiling for the mental health and psychology field. And that's another thing that's huge, not just for women here in the States, but for women that look like me who are Africans in Africa. And so I always say I don't represent just my little circle or my household. I represent women, I represent Black women, and I represent minority women, and I represent all African and African American women. So that was not just a win for me, but that was a win for all of us. Mm-hmm. All of us who look like me, who resonate with me, who have anything that is a piece of me, even if it's just a conversation. That's a win for all of us. And I always say power is, it does not work unless it's shared. And so a win is power, and sharing it is what makes power powerful. Otherwise, it's nothing.
Let me rephrase that in my own words. Power works better when it's shared.
It only can work if it's shared.
Yes.
Only can work if it's shared.
Definitely.
It's not yours to have.
I want to thank you so much for your time on our show.
Thank you.
And I wish you continual success in your business.
Thank you, Yaba. Thank you so much for holding a space like this for conversations that need to be had that people are not having, or they're just not bold enough like you to have those conversations. So thank you so much.
You're welcome. We need to take a quick break to acknowledge our sponsors. When we come back, we will continue with our show. Don't go away. Be back. Welcome back to the Yaba TV show. My name is Yesia, your host. Today we are talking about bridging the gap between Africans and African Americans. My first guest was Dr. Cheyenne Bryant, African American woman, and now I have Osayande Agaze, an African man, a Nigerian for that matter, who is into the movie industry in Hollywood. We're going to find out all of that in just a few seconds. Greg, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Yaba. Thank you very much. This is a great opportunity to be on this platform.
Yes.
And thank you for the great work you've been doing all these years,
trying to
bridge that gap. And that's a very good job you've been doing. I have to take it. It's a pleasure. It's an honor being here on
thank
the show.
You. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Sometimes you don't feel as appreciated as much until somebody comes back and tell you, hey, we've been watching you.
We could do more to appreciate you. Yes. You've been a treasure and you've done an amazing job in this community, and we all acknowledge that. And on behalf of everyone that has watched the show, we all respect and acknowledge you.
Thank you.
Thank you for the great work.
I appreciate it.
Thank you for the great work.
So let's talk about this crucial topic, bridging the gap between Africans and African Americans. We have a fine difference and we have similarities. Let's talk about the communication part. In Africa, as you know, most of the time when you're a youngster, younger one, talking to older person, you cannot give an eye contact directly in most part of African continent, in the continent, most part of the countries, many countries,
yes.
They decide or their culture dictates to them that a child should not look straight in the eye of the elder person. So what do you think about that? In America, it's different. You have to give me an eye contact.
Yes, I agree with you that in America it's quite different, where you are expected to stare directly in a direct gaze at your older person or whoever you're communicating with. If you don't do that, in fact, there's a repercussion for it. They may think you're lying, you are avoiding the direct eye contact, whereas in Africa it's quite different. I think understanding these things and how this contributes to some of the issues that you just mentioned, creating that gap, we all have to take a step back and look at pre-colonial Africa and look at what the current African situation is now.
Mm-hmm.
In pre-colonial Africa, that used to be the case, but currently, I think a lot of things have changed as well. But how do we now translate, how do we bring that information, and how do we use that differences, or how do we look at that differences and then be able to use it as a learning point between our African-American brothers and sisters and our Africans in the motherland? That debate has been going on for quite some time, but I'm so glad that even there is a little gap still there, there is a lot of improvement has been made.
Yes.
There are more Africans are traveling. I recently was in Ghana, where about 500 African-Americans took the citizenship.
Oh, Ghana is a place
it's
most African-Americans
yes.
go. They love Ghana.
And that's
definitely.
Amazing. And also Stevie Wonder just announced that he's going to move to Ghana.
Ghana, yeah.
And I want to go where Stevie Wonder goes.
So, you know, I have a show on his station,
yes,
KJL.
Yes,
so exactly. Every Sunday at
yeah,
6 o'clock.
That is
live.
Amazing. That is
yes.
amazing. So we there are challenges. There are still challenges that is yet to be overcome. But overall, I think African Americans themselves has also the development of Black studies in the institutions has brought us some new information about Africa that many people also did not know before.
Mm-hmm.
So we are seeing a change in the dynamic. We are seeing changes, and part of those
changes that, indeed.
Yes.
When we talk about changes, one
yes.
of the changes we are seeing,
yes.
you know, most of the time back then in
yes.
Africa,
yes.
when somebody has a bloated stomach,
yes.
it's a sign of good living.
Yes.
And when they're heavy set, it's a
yes.
sign of good living.
Pot belly.
Unlike here, it's different.
Yes.
But this same style from here is yeah. moving back home now, where
yes.
people are beginning to consciously be aware of
yes.
their health and
yes.
wellness.
Yes.
So they
yes.
don't want to be fat anymore. They don't want to have a bloated stomach anymore.
Exactly.
So changes. That's one of the changes.
Yeah, the changes. And the one thing that is constant is change. And what we're seeing is that there is a global consciousness, a global Afrocentric consciousness that is blowing around. And you see, we look at the injustice that's going on, the police brutality in America, and how it spread and the demonstration and the protest against such treatment of our African-American brothers back here. This is becoming a global consciousness. And in this consciousness, we are beginning to develop a global Afrocentric viewpoint where blacks in Brazil, Blacks in Venezuela are beginning to identify more with motherland. Mm. And this is a trend that is just beginning to take shape in terms of intellectual and physical relocation. We are seeing that from a lot of African Americans who are now deciding to visit Ghana, visit historic places in Africa, instead of going to France or Paris and so on and so forth. So we hope that this continues.
You have a product.
Yes.
I'm going to change the gear a little bit. You have a product. It's bitter leaf product.
Yes.
Made out of bitter leaf capsule.
Yes. Yeah, made out of African product. Yes.
Some of the things that bitter leaf is good for, tell us.
Yes. Well, bitter leaf it's been one of the oldest herbal products that have been used in Africa for medicinal reasons, for a lot of medicinal purposes. High blood pressure, hypertension, high cholesterol, and many, many more benefits that I can't even name on air right now. But what we've seen so far as part of the global consciousness, the African looking inward, and the rates of diabetics, like you just mentioned, has been growing in Africa. Overweight has been an issue, hypertension, blood clot, and a lot of things has been problem. And instead of Africa shipping all his money to import some diabetes medication in Africa, so I and some other African doctors and engineers and pharmacists did come together. We created Nature Herbal Life. I decided to look at African natural product as a way to mitigate the cost of healthcare in Africa. Mm-hmm. And this is really growing fast right now. Mm-hmm. We are trying to establish a factory in Ghana as well. So we're trying to see that Africa can really find its own economic foot by looking inward, looking at what is inward and what we can use to mitigate issues that are affecting us health-wise.
And we need a firm foundation.
Yes.
Very strong corruption foundation. And bribery.
Yes.
As erupt almost in every part of Africa, almost.
Yes, I agree. But in spite of those corruptions, what we've been able to do is develop products that are useful and that we can even export to America. Right now, our bitter leaf capsule is on Amazon, is the biggest selling in Costco and Walmart. So what we try to teach our African and most of the rural farmers that are farming this bitter leaf is that if they choose to, we can actually pay them in hard currency. And this was very exciting to these farmers. We said, oh, so you want to pay us in dollars? Sure, we want to pay you in dollars. That gives you some certain level of immunity from your local economy. So you are
and
really
produce more.
And produce more. And yes, they jumped up. They're like, hey, I want to produce more bitter leaf if you're going to pay me in dollars. And that is where African economic and farmers has been cut off. They don't have the access to sell their product like Chinese people do. Mm-hmm. They can just sell their product on Amazon directly and get hard currency. Mm-hmm. So that way, the politicians may be as corrupt as they want, but we are dealing with the rural women who are now very empowered, who are making money, hard currency. They don't even worry about the local exchange because they are making hard currency. And that is a way to cut all the corruption, go straight to the people who are going to benefit more from your product or the service they are rendering, and then continue to focus on that.
And that's bringing revolution to Africa.
Revolution, economic revolution.
Having said that, yes, tell our audience how they can reach you.
Oh, you can reach me at Greg at Hollywood Entertainment Productions, or they can just reach me, Greg Usayende 1 at Instagram, or they can just type my name anywhere. I'm everywhere. So it's just type Greg Usayende, I'll pop up, and you can reach my Facebook, my Instagram, every access is.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank
for
you.
Your
this
time
is a
on
pleasure.
Our show.
This is a pleasure. It's amazing, and
you're one
I'm
of
glad.
Africa's eyeball.
Oh, I like to think like that. But with people like you, with your support and exposure, and we are all following your footpath and trying to emulate what the good examples you've set.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Well, we need to take a quick break to acknowledge our sponsors again. When we come back, we will wrap up with the show. Don't go away. People have often told me, just when they are having so much fun with the Yaba TV show, time is up. Well, time is up again. But we are on every Sunday at 2 p.m. on Channel 13, KCOP. So tell your friends, tell your neighbors, tell everybody you know about our show, because we are coming your way to bring you African and African-American shows that will really educate you, entertain you, and inform you. If nothing else, you will have so much fun with our show. The music videos is totally out of this world. So till then, we will see you next week at the same time on the Yaba TV show, your contemporary bridge to the motherland, Africa. Oh,
The prior program was sponsored by Yaba TV.